I want to finish with a story that we all know in Mark chapter 5. And this is where we go to the picture. Because Jesus speaks to one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet and begged him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, that she may be healed, and she will live." So Jesus went with him, and a great multitude followed him and thronged him. Now in between he adds the story of the woman with the issue of blood, okay? And then we know that after the woman got healed, while he was still speaking, while Jesus was still speaking to the woman and saying, "Daughter, your faith has made you well," some came from the ruler of the synagogue's house who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher?" You see, your dream, it could be for your marriage, it could be for your children, it could be for your future, it could be for your health. Someone will come and tell you it's not going to work. So, you know, even circumstances will come and tell you it's not going to work. And you know, amazing enough, can I give you a percentage of the negative stuff that's going to hit you against the positive stuff that's going to help you? 80-20. Why? Because there were a number of spies that were sent to spy the land. 12. And 10 came back and brought the negative report. And only 2 came back and he said, "Nah, we can take that. We can do that." So you will have a mass of negativeness that will attack you against one or two things inside your mind that you can grab hold of and say, "I'm going to believe this. I'm not going to believe that. I'm going to believe this." See? And Jesus said, as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Just believe. Just don't believe. Continue." What else is there? What's the alternative? You know how many times people say to me, "Yeah, but you know, I'm tired of believing." And I say, "Well, what's the alternative? Well, don't go and die. Get a divorce. Kill your children. What is the alternative? What are you going to do now that you know what you're doing? You're saying, 'I'm tired of standing. I want to sit down, lie down, and die.'" Not me. Another person. You see, and that's the thing. What's the alternative? But we have been so pressurized by a world that requires instant solutions that it's so hard to hang in there waiting for that seed to sprout, to come to life. Just imagine, I'll give you an example. You'll have to give me an extra 5 minutes. I'll give you an example. Imagine you were the mother of a certain, let's name him Joseph. No, let's name him Benjamin. Benjamin was a very, very bad boy. He lived in the times of Jesus, and right from preschool, he started beating up on his little buddies and doing things he shouldn't have done with his little girlfriends and smoking stuff that he shouldn't have smoked and taking pills. And he grew up like that. He got mixed up with the wrong company. And all of a sudden, Benjamin became a very violent man. And he started robbing and he started taking stuff that wasn't his, until eventually one day he was busy stealing in a house in Jerusalem, and a Roman soldier caught him. And as it was, the Roman soldiers turned his eyes from him for a second, and Benjamin had a hidden blade and killed the Roman soldier. And he started running away, but unbeknown to him, there were other soldiers that saw it happen. So they captured him and they put him in jail and they condemned him to be crucified, which was the public demonstration of Roman justice. You mess with Rome, you pay. And so they put him in jail. Just imagine his mother. His mother prayed all his life. She started praying when he was in prison. She prayed for him through middle school. She prayed for him through college. She prayed for him through the first time that she started hearing about him doing wrong stuff, doing drugs and everything. She prayed him through the violent years of his life, and then she heard that he got caught and condemned to death. And she kept on praying, and kept on praying, and kept on believing, and kept on believing. And she offered this child to God. Because she offered this child to God when he was born, she knew that there was a seed of faith in there. She knew that there was something that she could stand on that was protected by the will of God. It had the provision of the goodness of God, and it had the potential to be saved and to become a great man. And so she prayed and prayed and prayed until eventually one day she was in the street called Via Dolorosa, and she saw her boy Benjamin carry his patibulum, his cross piece for the cross, on his shoulders while being flogged by numerous Roman soldiers and spat upon by the people. He was a criminal. It was right that he would die, that he should die. And so they planted his cross on the right hand side of three crosses. And they lifted up his patibulum with him attached to it until he was hanging from that cross. And they nailed his feet to the wall, to the pole. And then eventually his friend, Jacob, also got crucified on the other side of the center post. Who was that center post for? Why was it there? And suddenly Benjamin was on the right and Jacob, not Zuma, the other one. Jacob was on the left. And then eventually a Nazarene came, long beard, blood caked vest, crown of thorns on his head, bleeding profusely from lacerations on his back, on his face, and on his whole body. And he gets lifted up and nailed to the cross in the middle. And the mother is still praying. And the seed is still dead. And then suddenly, in the middle of all the jeering and the cruelty and the spitting and the blasphemy, he hears his friend Jacob join in to spit upon the man that was lying in the middle. And Benjamin turns around and says, "Jacob, why do you say that? We deserve what's happening to us. But this man hasn't done anything." Now, how did he do that? How did he know that? Well, he just knew. Well, God just told him. Well, God was busy. You see, Jesus says, "They will not come to me unless the Father draw them." So the Father was drawing. That's a promise. That's a life in the seed. That's a protection of the will. He desires Benjamin to be saved. So that's what you can stand on. You can stand on the fact that not you desire for your son to be saved, for your daughter to be saved, for your marriage to be healed, for your health to be good, but it's his desire for you to do that. And so he says, "Why? But we deserve it, but he doesn't deserve it." And then he turns around to the man lying, to the man crucified in the middle, and he said, "Lord," which is not translated in a context of the way that we know Lord. He wasn't calling him Lord in the sense of Lord. He was calling him Lord in the sense of a very important person, Adonai, master. It's like today an African person would say, "Boss." "Lord, remember me when you get into your kingdom." And that instant, rain showered on that seed, and the plant began to grow. And Jesus turned around and he said, "Today, you're going to bloom. Today, Benjamin, your seed is coming alive." How long did that mother pray for? No, obviously that's not in the Bible. but this is Mario's version. But maybe, well, for sure he had a mother. That's statistic proof that everybody's got a mother, even the ones that live in a two fathers family. They need a mother to be born. And so, how long? We don't know. How long has she waited for the drain? We don't know. But eventually it rained, didn't it? It rained. Right at the last minute, right at the last second. He was just about to enter. In fact, he died a little while later. Because the Bible says that the soldier went around and Jesus had already died. And so he was very close to dying. And then the soldier broke his legs, and then of course that collapsed, that stopped the ability to relieve the lungs, and then he died of suffocation. The moment that the legs were broken, he died of suffocation. So he was a few minutes away from entering into eternity as an unsaved person, as an unregenerate person, as a sinner, and going to hell. And yet at that moment the rain came and the seed revived. And as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said, "Do not be afraid, only believe." And he permitted no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Then he came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue and saw a tumult. And those who whipped him wailed loudly. There will always be someone that will declare over you that it's not going to work. And that it's done, it's finished. The daughter is dead. Now watch what Jesus says. When he came in, he said to them, "Why make this commotion among you? The child is not dead, but he's asleep. The seed is not dead, but he's asleep. Your vision is not dead, it's asleep. Your dream is not dead, it's asleep. Your prayer is not dead, it's asleep. Just wake him up. Come on, Sleeping Beauty, wake up. Come on, wake up. The child is not dead, he's asleep." What did Jesus do on the boat when they crossed the sea? He slept. And then they ridiculed him when he had put them all outside. He took the father and the mother and the child and those who were with him, and where the child was lying. Then he took the child by the hand and said to it, "Talitha kumi," which is translated, "Little girl, I say to you, arise, wake up." Immediately the girl arose and woke, for she was 12 years of age. Now for a long time, you know me, I don't take kindly to things I don't understand. And for a long time I couldn't understand why, what is 12 years of age have to do with the fact that she woke up? Immediately the girl arose and walked. Why? Because she was eating? No, because she was 12 years of age. What's that got to do with anything? Until yesterday I checked the meaning of number 12, and number 12 means complete. And the moment that you understand that everything that had to be done was done, you complete. Now is the time when the seed can arise, when the child can arise. Why? Because it's complete. Jesus has spoken the final word. Everything that had to be done has been done. And now she can walk, arise and walk. And then watch what Jesus tells you to do with your dream, with your vision, with your prayer. He says, "Give us something to eat. Come on, feed it. Feed it. Feed it. Feed it some. Feed. She's awakened. She's now feed it. Feed that. Feed that dream. Feed that vision. Feed it with positiveness. Feed it with prayer. Feed it with give us something to eat. She's been weak for a long time. She was asleep. She wasn't dead. She was asleep, waiting for the rain to fall. Now give us some food." Now, I'm finished. The suggestion. After you've done all you can do. We spoke about the farmer. He tilled the ground, he sowed the seed, fixed the ground. Most probably he weeded the ground, he prepared the stones out, he did what he had to do. And then what did he do? After all you've done, all you can do, take a nap. Go to sleep. There is such power in rest. Rest is the backbone of trust. You cannot trust and struggle. If you trust, you rest. That's why I put the little baby there. Because the picture of trust is when a baby sleeps. He doesn't ask you, did you put electricity in the meter? Or are the lights going to go out again in the middle of the night and I'm going to get scared? Did you make that application to the job because tomorrow I need some more formula? Have you got money to buy formula? I need milk. Did you change the car? Did you put the new baby seat in the car? I don't want to travel in the car, you know, floating around. What if an accident happened? I don't want to fly through the windscreen. Did you do that? Did you fix it? No, you put it up. Put it up. Dad, Mom, you can handle it. Good night. And there's a tremendous power in the ability to rest when God has reigned and waiting for the seed to come alive. So maybe, if I can encourage you, let's all do this. I want you to close your eyes quickly and I want you to think of the sleeping beauty in your life that needs to wake up. Maybe it's a prayer that needs answer, maybe it's a dream, maybe it's a vision, maybe something. And on the count of three, I want you to say, believing in your heart. Remember what I said about that? Trusting God. I want you to say, wake up. One, two, three, wake up. Arise. Hallelujah. Daddy God, thank you for the revelation of your word. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your love. Thank you for little things like seeing Jesus declaring, your dream is not dead. It's only sleeping. Tell it to arise. Talita kumi. Little girl. Dream, vision, prayer. Arise and walk because you have been completed. And I bless you, my friends, in the name of Jesus, with life and life abundant. Amen.